AGM. Before we begin today, I would like to acknowledge the lands on which we're meeting on and the lands on which UWA operates. The land of the Wadjuk Noongar people at the Crawley campus and the land of the Menlong Noongar people at the Albury campus. This land was stolen, never ceded, always was, always will be Aboriginal land. Okay, so does anyone have any declaration of potential or perceived conflicts of interest? Maybe that's a bit better. Yeah.
Stand behind the pole. Like, yeah, yeah. Stand there, yeah.
Moving on to confirmation of previous minutes. We don't have any previous minutes to confirm because the 2020 OGM was cancelled due to coronavirus. Moving on to the Guild President's report. It's been an honour to serve as the 108th student Guild President. 2025 seeing several challenges and achievements from the committed students and staff in the UWA. Student representatives have worked hard towards improving our 25,000 strong UWA community while navigating a fast changing environment of COVID-19 and university structural change. I would like to congratulate my team, the 108th Guild Council, and all other students who have worked hard to improve the experience of those around them. They were all strong advocates for their fellow students and have had an impact on the campus around them, acting on great events and initiatives. Strategic achievements from this year. Improving student support. This year we need to secure an upgraded passes for the summer school impacted by the COVID-19 lockdown. We also secured 7 days no questions asked special consideration during the semester one COVID lockdown. We increased emergency funding and financial conditions during the COVID-19 snap lockdowns. And coordinated COVID-19 India Relief fundraiser for Give India, as well as support groups and listening circles for students impacted by crisis overseas. We've also worked to increase engagement. We've provided weekly updates on social media to all UWA students. We've embedded the faculty society orientation videos into Illness. We've posted weekly free breakfasts on campus and night markets in the Grove. We've also worked hard to represent the student voice. We've relocated the semester two mid-semester break into week six. We've brought in minimum 7 days notice for assessment changes. We've advocated for a welcome to country to be embedded into LMS Blackboard. And we've submitted submissions to the university on the underpass tunnel refurbishment, as well as the state and federal government on the introduction of the ferry road. We've also worked to improve spaces on campus. We've refurbished the furniture in Catalyst Just Cafe. We've worked to make the Catalyst Cafe to students outside of library hours and also introduce a hot water tap and additional microwaves. Cool, that's everything from me. Thank you all for paying attention and bearing with me through those struggles. Of the 2021 budget, which will be presented by Will, the General Secretary.
Hello, everyone. we'll be going, so I guess this meeting will be going by the annual report for 2020, which is the financial, the budget summary for last year. And I guess an important thing to note in that is that we had a surplus of around 850K. And I guess I'll touch on later how it looked for this year, but we'll again reflect on it next year for the 2021 budget. So I guess to touch on this year, after last year's budget, COVID-19 snap lockdown, as well as loss of JobKeeper, has really impacted our commercial partners in UWA outlets. At mid-year, we were looking at around 400K orientation, grant funding, and conference costs. Obviously, run them or have use of their money. And no grant money for clubs is granted because of this review. Currently, we sit on an anticipated around 200k loss or less. And we thank the Guild staff and the student departments who have endeavoured to work within the restrictions of the media budget review to keep in track and in line. Obviously, some student departments haven't been able to do that, but we're working on that. And fortunately, due to the surplus that we had from last year, the Guild is keen to be in a stable financial position heading into 2022. Thank you.
Thank you, Will. Next on, we're going to move to the annual report. The 2021 annual report is currently still being written and put together. The 2021 annual report will be released at the end of this year or early next year. I'm just going to quickly go over the 2020 annual report, which wasn't presented because we didn't have an OGM last year. But last year, we worked hard to improve student support, especially during the COVID-19 crisis. We introduced operational efficiency within Student Assist to enhance student access to that service. We also worked alongside the university to provide grants, food and advice to our students as they navigated the COVID-19 crisis and accessing resources. We also worked to increase engagement. During the COVID-19 lockdowns, we moved nearly every event online, as well as field volunteering. We produced Ask Me Anything Q&As on Instagram, in addition to email updates in partnership with the university. We also work to have better spaces on campus, such as introducing the IGA and the installation of ROLL. We also worked hard to represent the student voice during the COVID-19 lockdowns through the Critical Incident Management Team, and we successfully advocated for ungraded passes and 14 days no questions asked special consideration. Next, we're going to move on to the financial statements, which will be being presented by Michelle, our finance director.
Thank you, Emma. For the year of 2020, the Guild has produced an income of 879,668,000. So that's close to 880,000. As expected, because of COVID, the revenue from the outlets has significantly gone down, as well as the revenue from the rental, because we've given significant amount of rental rebates. But including also the finance income and the commission income. But the income that we got from the JobKeeper has more than covered the reduction in all of those revenue streams. So we were able to have a significant amount of income in 2020 of $880,000. Due to this, we were able to increase our investment portfolio by close to $250,000. We also spent quite a significant amount of money in capital expenditures in 2020 despite COVID. So we've invested in website, the Guild Village precinct, fit outs and improvements in student spaces. So that's close to $300,000 expenditures in CapEx. We're still gonna have some expenditures in CapEx for this year in 2021, but we're trying to hold off on the money because of what's happening in COVID and all the uncertainties that come with it. I think that's about it for the audited financial statements for 2020. Do you have any questions?
Thank you so much, Michelle. So now we're going to move on to motions on notice. Before we start, I would like to remind everyone that Section 60G of the Guild Standing Order states that ordinary general meetings of the Guild can only pass motions to provide a recommendation to Guild Council, which must be endorsed by Guild Council before it takes effect. So, motions on notice 8.1. The Guild is pleased to accept the result of the referendum held between September September 20 to 23, in which students rejected the current restructure. It implores the student representatives in the Senate to vote according to the referendum results in any vote which occurs during future Senate meetings. It directs the student representatives in the Senate to act in accordance with the results of the referendum. This includes, but is not limited to, raising the referendum results at the Senate meeting on October 18, 2021, asking the Vice Chancellor for an official response to the results to be emailed to all students, and releasing a statement that reflects the student Senate representatives' acceptance of the results and willingness to challenge it in the Senate meeting, in collaboration with the UWA Education Action Network coordinator. I would like to invite Nicole McEwen and Scott Harney if they wish to speak on the motion.
Thanks. I bring this motion because I think the campaign we've run this semester has been incredible. We've managed to save two jobs in social sciences. We've managed to delay the outcomes in social science, in molecular science, and have been able to galvanise a campaign with hundreds of students coming out to protest against these cuts against the Senate meetings, with dozens of students occupying the Vice-Chancellor's meeting in the Senate, and with thousands of students coming out to vote yes in the referendum to say that they want to save social science, they want to save molecular science, and they want to stop job cuts and all of the restructure that's happening currently that they just rejected. So I think 89% of students that voted in that referendum said that they voted to stop the cuts. So that's a huge, huge endorsement of the campaign. And I think that it would be basically criminal not to raise these results in the Senate meeting, where the people who are making all of these decisions, who are ultimately the people who run and are accountable for running this university, we elect representatives to these meetings for this exact purpose. A guild is meant to represent and defend student rights and interests, and so the key thing that our representatives need to be doing is using every single opportunity they have in every official structure they have to cause as much of a fight around this as possible. So I would encourage everyone to come to the Senate protest on Monday, the 18th of October at 5 p.m. And I would encourage people who sit in the Senate to actually use their voice to speak out against this, so that while we're protesting outside, there will actually be something happening inside, bringing this result to them. I think that there's been a number of hurdles this year in actually having the guild representatives do the job that meant to be to represent students. So, like, for example, in the first academic board meeting, there was no student who actually spoke up. It was good that that was turned around for the second academic board meeting. But I think it shows that without pressure, we have like mass campaign that is putting that pressure on our student representatives, without motions like this that say this is what we want to happen, even if it's more representative and the guild has to endorse it later, it's extremely important. So I would encourage everyone to vote for this motion, and I'll let Scott speak on it further. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm just building off what Nicole said. I think the context for moving this motion as well is the strategy that the UWA Student Guild has had for the past couple of decades. It's had a strategy of working with management rather than confronting it. It sees itself as being a part of that management, managing cuts to education, kind of coming up with clever plans that work for the people at the top, but not doing its basic function, which is to defend the rights and interests of students at every single juncture. So we're moving this motion because there's quite obviously an appetite on campus to fight against these cuts, and the UWA Student Guild should be the body that is leading that fight. Not just the Education Action Network, it should be the Guild President, it should be the Postgraduate President, it should be every single office bearer that is a part of the UWA Student Guild, picking up a fuss, rocking the boat and trying to fight these cuts as much as possible. So I think what needs to happen is that the representatives that sit on the Senate need to go to the next meeting and basically give the Vice-Chancellor a living hell and not accept any other answer but we're going to drop these cuts, and we want a response to the referendum that just happened. I think there needs to be a total reorientation with the strategy of the UWA Student Guild. In the past, the UWA Student Guild has actually voted for education cuts. When I first came to this campus, they voted for a restructure which resulted in 300 staff cuts. And then last year, the Guild President endorsed a $70 million restructure. So we need to definitively say we're against this and we're going to continue to fight it as a student guild because that's what student guilds do.
It's the last thing to stop that the undergraduate degrees a lot of us did from being gutted And at least, even if the guild just has to symbolically confront the body that is making that decision that is going to derail all of our careers and all of our academic paths, I think that's something we should all vote for and something that we should all support.
Yeah, I'm Catherine and I've been a part of the campaign. And yeah, I really agree with what everybody who's spoken for this motion so far has said. And I think something that's really notable about this campaign against the cuts is just how many students who've never been involved in something like this before have gone and, like Fraser said, thrown all their weight behind this. And it's not just students whose course is being particularly targeted at the moment. There's been students from all across the board who see this as a really important issue. They care about the fact that their course could be next. They care that there's other students here who might lose their courses, and they care about the staff as well, 400 of which might lose their jobs. And I think in saying that, like, this is a big, one of the big things of this campaign is about student democracy. 89% of students who voted in the referendum voted yes, and more people voted in the referendum than voted for a race candidate. That shows that this is an issue that people actually take seriously. And when ordinary students are the ones who actually have to throw their weight behind this to push this campaign forward, you can understand why they feel a bit demoralised with the guild when, seemingly the guild really doesn't seem to be doing enough. And yeah, I think sometimes with the current state of the guild, it'd be easy to forget that first and foremost, it's a student union. Things like free breakfast programs and night markets or whatever is a great extra, but really, I don't care about a night market if staff are going to be cut from student services, library staff are going to be cut, your tutors are going to be cut. And these are the lives of 400 people as well. This is their livelihood and jobs that are going to be lost. And these are students who put hard work into their courses that they might just be cut. And I think the fight as well, like, it really sets a precedent that student activism can actually achieve things. We've managed to save two jobs back so far, which is only a small victory, but it's very significant when you're coming up against an absolute behemoth like Ahmed Sharma, who's just dedicated to, like, cutting the hell out of this university. So the fight really sets a precedent that actually students can win when they fight back against, like, cuts and austerity. And the students should have a say over their education that when they put their weight into it, they actually do. So I think for all those students who really put a fight into it, the guild owes them to actually take their concerns forward, to take their concerns into the Senate meeting, and to really actually build on this campaign and give students what they expect from the people that they elected to represent them.
I'll keep it short, but I think that we're at a really critical point in time where we have good results and the resounding win from the referendum, and we can take this to the university and we can show them this is how students feel about this. What are you going to do with this? Like, are you going to listen to the student voice? Are you going to, like, stop this, or are you just going to keep doing what you're doing and ignore student democracy? And so I think it's really important that we sort of kick up a big fuss around the next Senate meeting, come to the Senate for this, pass this motion. I just think this is really, really important.
So Melissa, class to go to. Can we wrap this up in one? Because I can't go, I have to go to class, I can't wait.
Yep, sure.
If everyone's okay, I'll put forward a procedural motion to limit speaking time of 1 minute. Seconded by Bill, all those in favour? Great, that passes.
I definitely support this motion. I think that doing things like this is exactly what student guilds are actually for and what student representatives should be doing. So, like, when the last guild president, you said that when the president sits on Senate, they're not acting as a student, but they're now acting as a member of the university executive. And that's been the approach of the guild for years and years. And I think that's a shameful position to take from somebody who, is specifically elected to represent the interests of students. And on the Senate and on all of these different boards, the executive tries to co-opt student representatives into defending them and kind of selling their attacks on education to students. But we shouldn't just accept that. I think that the student representatives who are on Senate should go into these bodies to represent students. And that involves, I think, at the Senate meeting, not just kind of politely telling them about the referendum results, but really making a fuss and pressing as much as possible the Senate members to respond. And keep pressing against whatever justifications they give and not accepting it. And I think that the people who are on the Senate should speak as well to this motion and to say what they're going to do and respond to what people have been saying and just commit to actually making a fuss and doing as well.
Are there any more speakers for or against?
Yeah, just wanted to speak on behalf of the international students. It's been a really tough year, and it has not made our situation any better. We've seen the referendum, and we've seen the results. I know it's time for the university to listen to the students' voices.
I would really love it if someone who is near the view of this year, not me or Issa, could actually come and respond to some of the stuff we're saying and what they think about this motion. I think it's really important. We've put this motion so that they can actually have a discussion about whether you're going to go into the Senate meeting and cause a fight. And so I think you actually need to say and commit here and now, regardless of how representative or whatever this motion is and whether it needs to get, you know, endorsed later down the track. I don't care. Someone needs to stand up here and say that they're going to take this to the Senate, that they think that's the correct thing to do, and they think the approach so far has been wrong. So someone come up here from STAR and say that, please.
Is everyone happy if we move on to a vote? Great. So see these red slips that we've all been given? If you are for the motion, please raise your red slip in the air. If you're against, yeah, all those in favour?
Where is mine?
All those against? Great, that motion passes. There's no items of general business. So thank you again for taking the time to attend this meeting. The next ordinary general meeting will be held in 2022 on a date yet to be decided.